Greetings, folks. Today, we have returned with a very fun little project of mine that I've been doing for a couple days, weeks now. I made my own Hive fleet. So, it's no surprise I love the Tyranids from Warhammer 40k, and I enjoy working on these fellas a lot. A lot of you, however, don't know that I love playing World of Warcraft. So, a while back in Battle for Azeroth, we had a mini expansion before the new Shadowlands I just dropped about like a week and a, like 2 weeks ago. It was called Visions of N'Zoth. So Visions of N'Zoth introduced these quite interesting looking fellows called the their version of the Aqir. Aqir have existed quite a while ago, but now they have a new look and they look freaking cool looking with their weird eldritch look shenanigans. So what I have done is combine both the Tyranids from Warhammer 40k, because I was kind of bored of the same old looking, look at me, I'm a bug with my little tiny mandible arms. Rawr. I decided to combine the two aspects and then make myself my own custom Tyranids. You see, with this fella here, this is a fully painted version of it, kind of using a little bit of that inspiration from the World of Warcraft duck here. And what I am working on here, and then I am going to be painting up this little white figurine that I had earlier. It's one of my Tyranid warriors. I'm gonna be making him look fancy, so we're gonna be working on that. Starting things off in this paint job, I'm gonna be layering the whole thing in Blood Angels contrast paint. Blood Angels red contrast paint. Now the reason for this is because the white base underneath gives us a very nice white coat. And all you need is one layer in this case, because the way how I did it was I did a very weird zenithal highlight. As you can tell, it's very bright white in some parts of it, and lower it is a very dark kind of white gray. I decided to do that instead of just your standard black and then white on top. And I actually did it quite different too. Instead of doing a spray can, I did dry brushing, which took a little bit for a whole army, but it was worth it for the result. So I just wet my brush a little bit, that way the contrast paint has an easier time flowing through everything, but not too much water, otherwise you will wind up with a pink tone. And the pink tone is not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for that rich blood red, like Blood Angels. Kind of self-explanatory. Reasoning for that is because the Aqir, their color schemes are lots of like different shades of red, usually on the bright to like very dark spectrum part of it. So there's a lot of good paints that we could work on to do that. I'll probably make a bunch of videos in the future of different Tyranid kitbashes, because this whole army I made is fully kitbashed, fully sculpted, fully like resin reused and casted parts. As you probably can already tell, this Tyranid looks a little choppy and not as smooth in some parts, especially the back here. That's because this little fella and almost my whole army, except for my Hive Tyrant and Hormigaunts, are all resin casts. Because Warhammer is expensive. And if you're doing kit bashing, it's kind of nice having a few spare parts around so you don't kind of ruin your nice fancy models that you just bought. Also, it just saves money anyway. Because, you know, Warhammer. Woo, expensive. So yeah, I'm just going to be covering this little guy. Girl thing. I'm not sure how the Tyranids work. They're just a maw of consumption. So, I'll be finishing up this little guy with the various paint slathers, and then we'll get back to the second step after that is all dried. See, in about 2, 3, 4 minutes. Alright, now that that is taken care of, we are going on to the next step. I'm going to grab this little brush right here. It's just a fine hair brush I use for dry brushing. And I'm going to dry brush Troll Slayer Orange all over the miniature. Not on the white parts. I probably should say, I only put it on the red flesh. Reason being is because I want that nice kind of weird gradient of blood red and orange. So that way it highlights it. Dry brushing your miniature for new painters or even experienced painters for catching out the details comes in handy if you want just quick highlighting. Or for more experts, you can use it as a way to blend colors without having to wet blend as much. So as you see, I'm just dry brushing it on the higher up parts of the model. So that way it catches each little bit here. So that way our model will be just a slightly brighter orange-red on all the highlights. Not by much. Enough to tell that the darker recesses within the model's mold is a shade. It's a darker shade. As if you're working on an actual painting or doing traditional art or digital art. When you're working on something and you're coloring it, you want the more bottom recesses of whatever you're making to be darker than the upper parts. For example, if you're working on a human face, you know that deeper within the eye sockets is going to be a little more darker. Not by much, but just a darker tone than it would be, let's say, on the cheeks, where they're a little more upright on the body's visual frame. Now, for the next part, we're going to be using Word Bearer Red. It's much darker, more fine than the Blood Angels Red, as you see right here. And then after we're done using that, I'm going to be showing you a fun way on how to make it look even darker. Give it a nice, like, kind of terracotta dark red look to it. What I'm going to be doing here, I'm going to be putting this color specifically on just and only all the little armored parts on the model. Carapace. Technically, the whole thing is wearing an exoskeleton, which is similar to that of a carapace. However, a carapace is a more thicker version made out of higher fine keratin, which is kind of the same stuff you will find in your hair. That is common found in insects, bugs, like true bugs. Think of your assassin bugs and weevils. And our crustaceans, a lot of crustaceans. It's pretty much almost every invertebrate that has an exoskeleton that is heavily armored, more of the pre-mentioned what I said earlier, will have a carapace. Almost all. There are a few exceptions for different species, and not to mention arachnids. A few of them don't have a carapace, because not as hard and refined, but they all have exoskeletons. It's another reason why I kind of like Tyranids. They got this weird insectoid xenomorph look going on. So I'm just slapping on the Word Bearer Red all on these parts of the model. On all the metal bits. Metal bits? Armored parts. I can't think right now. I'm tired. Well, while I'm working on this, so that way I'm just painting up everything here with my little brush. Whoops. I'm just painting this little guy up. What are your folks' favorite thing for Warhammer 40k, or if you're a fellow Tyranid fan, what's your favorite Tyranid faction? I, for one, quite enjoy the idea of High Fleet Hydra being the disposal unit and the consumer of offshoot and, like, splintered High Fleets. So that way they just find them, eat them up, and then gain their adaptations or whatever else of their gene code that they want. More genes for the gene pool. Skulls for the skull throne, cough, cough. Corn, cough, cough. Yeah, I like them due to the fact that they're kind of weird. It's portraying more on animals like cannibalistic behavior towards those of a similar species or their own species. It's actually surprisingly quite common in amphibians and insects to see cannibalistic acts. In some fish as well. Snakes sometimes, but not as often. It's mostly found in just the other species I've mentioned prior. So it's pretty neat that they have that. Another one I actually kind of like the idea of, and I wish was expanded more on. Hopefully when the Tyranids get their new updated codex, we'll be able to see a new version of it. High Fleet Jormungandr. Those little guys, I actually like the idea of too. With the fact that they burrow and do all their weird little shenanigans underground and consume prey and destroy them. I like that idea. But what I really have a fun idea for is making them all snake-like. Hence their name Jormungandr, which is like, you know, I don't know, Norse world serpent. So I'm thinking, I actually did a video a while back on a thematic list on using a lot of units that embody what Jormungandr is all about in terms of 40k. A lot of like burrowing and underground shenanigans. But besides that, so this army I made, which you currently are seeing me paint and probably got from the title, is High Fleet Aqir. And the goal of this army that I made them to be is a very heavy, oddly enough, anti-horde, elite horde army. So I kind of made like a weird Astromilitarum Tyranid army, if that makes any sense. I have about like 40 Hormigaunts with Devourers, and then I have about two squads of these warriors, each with Despiters and Thorn Cannons, like this guy's holding. So that way I have not only a lot of shots, and when I mean a lot. Like, one squad of those 20 Hormigaunts, not only do they get to reroll on failed saves, wound rolls, which means if they do not succeed on wounding the target, they get to reroll again. Unless if it's for hit, and I'm getting confused with something else. It's one of those. You can just reroll and continue shooting, and each of those little devourers have three shots. So 3 times 20, that's about 60 shots going into something from that squad. That's a lot of bullets. Not to mention, the little warrior squads already have 3 shots per model, and then the cannon has 6 shots with the keyword blast, which means it does better against horde groups. So yeah, my army has a lot of blast and a lot of shots. And then I just have a squad of 6 little neurothropes and 1 zoanthrope. I think I reversed the names again. Now, second part here, I'm going to use my phoenician purple. And I'm going to slather this on the fleshy bits. Fleshy bits? I know. I thought they didn't have fleshy bits. Well, surprise, they do. In this case. Merely, I'm just putting it on where I've sculpted on the tentacle faces, similar to that of the Nazoth here. Just to paint it up with that nice purple. It contrasts very nicely against the different shades of red going on. And as a matter of fact, sometimes when I'm adding these purple shades, I kind of blend in some of that red a little bit to give it a nice gradient from the base all the way down to the bottom part of the neck. So it has a nice gradient shade going on. And then I gotta do the same thing to that little thorn sac on the gun. I'm not quite sure what to call that. I'm just gonna put that there. Slather that in. Alright. Oops. Kind of put that out of your vision so you folks couldn't see. Now, I do use most of my paint straight from the pot. I know you're not supposed to do that. That's heresy. It's a bad, bad paint job, my guy. But, I kind of just like using out the pot, to be honest. It gives that nice, thick coat. Which works for me, because I spread the paint everywhere to get that nice coverage.
And my brushes are already wet. That was weird. My brushes are already wet. So by the time the paint touches it, it's already kind of wet. And so I kind of like skip a whole process there. Save some time. Especially when you're painting up a giant army like what I did. With this army, I painted it all up for a weekend to test it out. See how well it's doing. Now, the reason why I haven't really been pausing the video, editing out a little bit right now, and kind of just going to town painting, is because I want these painting videos to try to be a little more not only informative, but a little more interactive, especially for newcomers to painting and also the channel. I want to be more on the personal level of fellow painters and newcomers alike, as almost as if I am in person with them, talking to them and helping them out with their little ideas. Which reminds me, if you folks have any questions, you always feel free to leave them in the comments section below of any of the videos, especially if it's on the topic of what I'm working on. Now for the last part with this purple, I'm going to be painting up the barrel of the gun, because all of my guns, barrels, are to be purple. Just for that extra added value of contrast. Except for that tube, we're going to do something with that later. Looks like a little spine. I actually kind of like that rich, like, pinkish purple going on right now. Which is good. That's kind of how their color scheme is supposed to look like based off WoW. You know, I'll do a video on that too in the future. A video on how to utilize video game paint schemes to improve your own paint schemes. Because a lot of video games, you want something to look cool, you gotta know how to do colors. Because if you don't, it's gonna look kinda bad. The look of things is everything if you want people to enjoy your universe. Alright. Now that that is taken care of, we're gonna let the model dry for about 2-3 minutes, and then we'll get back to work on the rest of the miniature. Now that that has been taken care of and dried, we are going to be touching up the rest of the model with Screaming Skull. So all the little white bits you see there and the carapace itself, we're going to be using this color as an off-white to make it pop a little bit. Wet brush, a little bit from the bot. We'll be painting up the nails here. Now, some would say I should invest in a wet palette. I would agree, however, I'll make my own. In this case, I don't necessarily need one. Because this is just one model, and it's a small and a quick paint job. Nothing too crazy, I'm not a professional, I just know how to paint well. But I'm not a professional, like those you'd see on, like, Miniac, Goobertown Hobbies, Squidmar Miniatures, and Midwinter Minis. Just a few little shoutouts for you people out there doing the great work that you do and inspire me to this day. But they are what I call professionals. They are really good. I, on the other hand, am kind of just, I'm alright. I do a good paint job here and there, but nothing like that. I'll get there eventually, the more time I take. As you could probably tell with a lot of these videos, I've become slightly better over time. At least I think so. So actually, a proud achievement of mine a while back is learning how to do a good wet blend. That was awesome! And that's for my big project I was working on that you guys have not yet to see. But that was super fun to work on. I feel like I'm missing something on this. Oh yeah, the chest and these. So this color scheme, I actually quite enjoy a lot. It's not crazy. It's nothing super, like, ooh, eye-catching. But it has this very unique, like, almost like bone and muscle kind of look going on. And I am loving it. Took me a bit to get the exact look I wanted after a few of Hormagaunt models I tested out. But this one really hit the nail on the coffin. That was the wrong term. It really hit the mark. Not too much D&D. It hit the mark pretty well. It was the exact look I was going for as an adaptation from a WoW color scheme and my own creation of kitbashing and sculpting. So generally, whenever you're making your own miniature-like stuff or trying to pimp out your little army, it's always alright to do some kitbashing and reforming of the model. In this case, I made silicone molds of all the parts, and then I casted them with resin. Now, this is actually pretty common for a lot of people when they're trying to replicate parts that they need instead of having to go on eBay. That's what I do. I will say, though, the only reason I do it is to help save money, because for, let's see, like a good amount of resin, I don't know the exact dimensions at the moment, I'm not looking at it. For $30, I was able to make an equivalent of 2 squads of warriors, mind you, 4 warriors in each squad, like fully built, even their weapons and arms, and 1 squad of 8 neurothropes out of like 1/3 of that resin and some dice on the side. That is a super steal compared to having to buy them by themselves, especially with me kitbashing these. That is a lot of money. Because, for example, over here in the US, neurothropes cost around like $60 to $65, depending on what retailer you get them from. That's pretty expensive in its own right for 3 models that you could turn into Venomthropes. That's expensive. And the Warriors are about like 50, like around that margin. I like Warhammer, but it's expensive. Like really expensive, a little too expensive. Just saying, GW. Sometimes the prices are a little expensive. Now, that being said, I do not sell these recasted parts for profit. I don't do that. That is not cool to do, and honestly, you should support your local game stores. Which I do. I actually buy a lot of models. Then I recast some bits for future kitbashing projects so I don't run out of that cool-looking part, and also because price. It's pretty cool. Now, what I'm doing here is I'm actually dry brushing on the Screaming Skull onto the carapace here to get that nice sort of ridged look. I'm not using like one of those makeup brushes. I'm actually using this brush where it's kind of dangling and stuff to get those nice little stripes you see going on. I'll be touching that up, however, with some of that little color I used prior. Nice. Alright. It's a dry brush, so it doesn't really take a lot of time to dry. In fact, the moment you put it on, it's already dry. Dry brush. Now, I'm going to get my regular brush I was using earlier, get some more of my Word Bearer red, and then touch up the carapace that I kind of messed up a little bit with some of that dry brushing. And after that is done, I will let it dry and then take on the final step. So, I'm going to be working on this, and I will get back to you folks in like 3-ish minutes. Now, for the final stage of this little project, well, final 2 stages, but the last one is kind of meh. It's very small. I'm going to be using my homemade black ink wash. pretty crazy. It actually has really good coverage. It's what I use for this guy right here to get that nice, like, rich colored version of the carapace and to get those nice little details within the little recesses there with the shade. So what I'm going to be doing now is slathering this all over the purple and the word bearer bits to get that nice dark color. However, soon in the future, I'll be making a little video on how to make that. If you don't have that little self-made wash that you probably have seen on other videos, mine is a little different. You could just use a nuln oil. That would do practically the same thing. This one just has more of a purple-gray hue, so it leaves a nice overall finish. Not only does it tint this red, but it also helps in darkening the very little recesses you see within the purple color itself. It's a very like blackish purple. I call it like a deep sea purple. Like stuff you would see around in the abyss and benthic areas of the ocean. If you ever watch those science documentaries. It has an overall nice finish. Just going to be putting that all over. However, I am being careful to not hit the very bright, like, screaming skull parts that I dry brushed onto it. Just want to tint that red and purple. Just selectively putting it where I want it, though. And I'll just put it on here for the gun. Whoops. Alright, cool. Oh, that's done. It just needs to dry. Which will be in like a couple of seconds, maybe a minute. Or when I'm done adding all the last details. I'm going to be using Flash Gits Yellow for the eyeballs. Get that nice, cool looking eye thing going on. Like what all the Aqir have, that nice, bright, like, orangish yellow, or just bright yellow. Now, generally, when you use a yellow, it's actually pretty smart to use a red undercoat. So it makes a richer version of the yellow you're trying to do, as you see here. Makes it much more rich. Oops, I forgot some cloth over there. Oh well. Makes it a lot brighter and gives it a very more handy undercoat. So make that look like an eyeball there. Put one there. And that just about does it. Thank you for joining my little video on how to make your own Tyranid color scheme based off the color scheme I did based off of a World of Warcraft color scheme. Yeah. Now... Thank you for stopping by and checking out my video. If any of you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment section below. And you can check out the other videos I have and probably see what else I have to offer. That is pretty much it for the day. You folks have a great day and take care.